Okay, so I'm going to do a weird thing today, which is don the hat of an incompatibilist for the purposes of this talk, not something I've ever done before, apart from when I gave a version of this talk a few weeks ago. Sorry to those of you who went to that talk. This is going to be very similar, but I'm hoping you've forgotten it by now. So, here's something that's happened in the free will debate in the last, I don't know, 20 years or something. It's kind of overgeneralization. But so for a long time, it was orthodoxy that acting freely was at least prima facie requires the ability to do otherwise, right? That's what you get in the consequence argument. Compatibilist strategies for coming up with a decent compatibilist conception of the ability to do otherwise were not in great shape. We had the kind of conditional analysis. Nobody really thought that was going to work. So what tended to happen is that compatibilists often tried to undermine or avoid the intuitive pull of the ability to do otherwise requirement by kind of shifting to talk of moral responsibility rather than freedom of the will. So, for example, you know, you get Strawson defending compatibilism by talking about reactive attitudes. You get Frankfurt on the principle of alternative possibilities, which is a thesis about moral responsibility. You get Dennett talking about why it is that moral responsibility doesn't require the ability to do otherwise, and so on. And I take it that part of what's going on there is that it's much... The intuitive pull of the idea that the ability to do otherwise is required for acting freely is kind of a little bit more... The pull's a little bit stronger than the idea that being morally responsible requires the ability to do otherwise. And so given that compatibilists weren't very good at coming up with a compatibilist account of the ability to do otherwise, they kind of shifted their focus onto talking about freedom of the will. Incompatibilists, for exactly the same reason, tended to talk about freedom of the will because that's where the intuitive pull of the requirement that we're able to do otherwise is kind of stronger. Seemed like a very smart move on both sides, given the state of the compatibilist story about how it might be that we could be able to do otherwise even if determinism's true. Things have shifted a lot recently. So incompatibilists now tend to talk a lot more about moral responsibility than they do about freedom of the will. You can quite often get through an entire paper defending incompatibilism where freedom of the will just sort of isn't mentioned at all. Compatibilists, on the other hand, are kind of moving in the other direction. So in Kadri's book, for example, she basically just doesn't really talk about moral responsibility at all. She's completely focused on freedom of the will. So why has there been that shift? Here are two possible reasons for the shift. One, and this is the one that I want to focus on, many incompatibilists have just been convinced by Frankfurt's famous case to give up on the principle of alternative possibilities. And the second reason, I think, is that compatibilist theories of the ability to do otherwise have massively improved. So Kadri, for example, gives a big, long story about how compatibilists can do the ability to do otherwise in her book. So, from a strategic point of view, then, for the incompatibilist, insisting on the kind of the forking path model, the ability to do otherwise, kind of no longer looks like such a great dialectical move. And so here's one thing that incompatibilists have done. They've stopped focusing on the ability to do otherwise as the kind of like the key feature of acting freely, and correspondingly, they talk less about free will and more about moral responsibility. And so the dominant strain of incompatibilism has come to be source incompatibilism now, right, rather than leeway incompatibilism. Now, the question I want to ask was this such a great idea? And I'm not so sure it was such a great idea for incompatibilists. For these reasons, first of all, it's just kind of not clear to me that ultimate sourcehood has any claim to be part of the ordinary notion of free will. I myself am not really sure what ultimate sourcehood is supposed to be. By contrast, the ability to do otherwise does have some kind of claim, I think, to being part of the ordinary notion of freedom of the will. And also, I think that the incompatibilist rush to endorse Frankfurt's argument against the principle of alternative possibilities was just kind of too hasty. And just speaking, you know, putting my compatibilist hat on for a bit, which is the one that fits much better, I'm kind of like, the thing that sort of keeps me awake a little bit at night is the consequence argument, and not kind of sourcehood or manipulation arguments. So From a strategic point of view, if you're an incompatibilist, I think there's much more traction if you want to kind of persuade some people who are inclined towards compatibilism. I kind of feel like leeway incompatibilism is a much kind of stronger button to push than source incompatibilism. So what I'm going to try and do in this paper is establish that third claim, the idea that incompatibilists really don't need to be as worried by Frankfurt's argument as many of them seem to be. That's the basic plan of the talk. So, old school incompatibilism kind of goes like this. Look, in deliberation, it sure looks we could go either way, right? It seems like we have a two-way power or regulative control. We're confronted with an open future, put it however you like. That seems to be what happens when we're deciding what to have for dinner or whatever it is. Indeed, you might think of that self-conception as kind of a necessary condition of deliberation. It has to seem to me as though there's more than one option available to me. In Frankfurt cases, of course, the situation is not one in which there's a genuinely forking path in front of you. Well, there kind of is, but one of the forks is blocked off. But if you think about a Frankfurt case, so I'm not going to bother to, let's just set up a Frankfurt case quickly. Jones is wondering whether to do something or other, doesn't matter what. Black has implanted the strange device in Jones's brain. If it looks like Jones is about to decide, Black really wants Jones to decide to A. So if it looks like Jones is about to decide not to A, Black's going to push his magic button, and that will kind of like steer Jones onto the course where he decides to A. So whatever Jones does, he's going to end up deciding to A, right? So even though the path in this case to deciding not to A is not available to Jones, there's still surely something, right, about Jones's self-conception where Jones is deliberating about whether or not to A. So he's not wrong to think that there's a fork in the road in some sense, even though he's wrong about where one of those forks leads. Now, of course, that's the starting point for flicker defenses of the principle of alternative possibilities, which isn't the line I'm going to take in this paper, but I think it's kind of important to keep in mind what the motivation for that kind of defense is, which is that even though all paths eventually lead back to Jones doing A, there kind of still is a fork in the road, and flicker defenders try and exploit the fact that there's still a fork in the road. So, Frankfurt, as I'm sure we all know, claimed to refute the following principle, the principle of alternative possibilities. S is morally responsible for A-ing only if S could have done otherwise than A. So if we assume that free will is necessary for moral responsibility, we get a slightly different principle, that S A's freely only if S could have done otherwise than A. So here's the way the source incompatibilist responds to, so various leeway incompatibilists have tried to respond to Frankfurt. So the flicker defense is a version of a leeway incompatibilist response. There are various other responses out there. Here's the way that source incompatibilists respond to Frankfurt. They say, look, Frankfurt's right about kind of almost everything here. He's right that Jones can't do otherwise, or at any rate, he's certainly right that Jones can't do otherwise than A. And he's right that Jones lacks what Fisher calls robust alternative possibilities. They might be these sort of like little flickers, but as Fisher argues, they're not robust enough to ground Jones's moral responsibility. So Jones can't do otherwise. He is morally responsible. Frankfurt's right about that as well. And finally, he's right about the idea that Jones's moral responsibility must therefore stem from, as it were, what went on in the actual sequence of Jones's deliberation. So Frankfurt's right about all of that. Where Frankfurt goes wrong, according to the source incompatibilist, is that he assumes that what goes for Jones, someone for whom there is, as it were, a forking path, even though one of the forks is blocked off, what goes for Jones goes for deterministic agents where there is no fork in the path at all, right? So Frankfurt says, look, if you look at what goes on in the actual sequence, that's what's important. If you look at, a deterministic version of Jones rather than an indeterministic version of Jones, you know, the actual sequence is just the same, so it just doesn't matter that there are these kind of like little possible offshoots. So that's the place where Frankfurt goes wrong, according to the source incompatibilist. It's really important that in the case as Frankfurt sets it up, that Jones's actual deliberation is not causally deterministic, right? Even though there's only one place it can end up, the process of actual deliberation itself is not deterministic. And that's why Jones, in the Frankfurt case, unlike a deterministic agent, is morally responsible, right? So the source incompatibilist concedes an enormous amount of ground to Frankfurt, but then says, basically, yes, everything you say about the case is right, but what you can't do is draw any inferences about the case of the deterministic agent. Okay. And so what follows from that is supposed to be the idea that what's important for moral responsibility, aside from the usual compatibilist conditions, is that the process that produces the action is not causally deterministic. Now, why is that? It's because satisfying that condition, that the process that produces the action is not causally deterministic, is necessary for the agent to be the source of their action. Right, so it's that, right? So the idea is that what's important about indeterminism is not that it delivers you alternative possibilities, it's that it puts you in a position where this further condition for acting freely can be met, whether it's agent causation or whatever it is you want to plug in at that point. So, source incompatibilists agree with Frankfurt that alternative possibilities are not in themselves important for moral responsibility. And they also agree amongst themselves that alternative possibilities are not in themselves important. They disagree about how unimportant they are, as I take it that Stump and Zagzebski, for example, think that they're completely unimportant, alternative possibilities. Dirk thinks that they're kind of not completely unimportant, but still pretty unimportant. But they're definitely not important, right? They kind of all agree on that. They all think that what's important, or most important, is the falsity of determinism. Now, you know, as it happens, the falsity of determinism, as it were, entails that there are some alternative possibilities or other, but it's the falsity of determinism that's important and not the fact that there are alternative possibilities. So, I want to suggest a different kind of incompatibilist approach to Frankfurt that hangs on to something like the principle of alternative possibilities. So grant that Frankfurt's right, that Jones lacks the ability to do otherwise, and also lacks, so he has some sort of feeble alternative possibilities are out there, but he lacks the ability to do otherwise than A, and he also lacks robust alternative possibilities, and yet is morally responsible. That just doesn't show that alternative possibilities are unimportant when it comes to moral responsibility. That's the claim that I want to put forward on behalf of the incompatibilist. And the main reason for that, I want to claim, is that the Frankfurt case is clearly a deviant case, right? It's a crazy case. These situations just don't arise in real life. And deviant cases tell us nothing about the true importance of alternative possibilities in general. So that's the claim that I want to argue for. So, and I think there are two ways to do this. So let me explain the two ways. I can't write on the blackboard. Right, okay, so here's the first way. And I'm just plagiarizing here from my colleague Anne Whittle, who has a 2014 paper in PPR where she argues for this. She is talking about sourcehood views in general. It doesn't matter whether they're compatibilist or incompatibilist, but I'm just going to think about the incompatibilist case. So she says, look, clearly the principle of alternative possibilities is false as it stands. Frankfurt shows that. We need some other alternative possibilities principle, and here's her suggestion. It's a ceteris paribus principle. So here's CP, PAP. Ceteris paribus, if S is morally responsible for an action A, then S could have done otherwise than A. So the idea is that we have this general rule, it's an alternative possibilities requirement on acting freely, it has exceptions, just like any ceteris paribus law has exceptions. Now, obviously we need to spell out how the ceteris paribus clause is going to work so that the ceteris paribus law isn't just trivially true, right? You don't want a law that turns out to look like this. If S is morally responsible for A, then S could have done otherwise than A unless she couldn't. That's not a very helpful law. But it doesn't look as though there's any danger that that's going to be the situation that the defender of CP PAP is going to find themselves in, because, as I say, the Frankfurt case is clearly deviant in obvious ways. And if you look at the debate about CP laws in the philosophy of science, most people accept that CP laws are perfectly legitimate things. What they do is they effectively exclude the deviant cases, but pretty much nobody thinks that they exclude the deviant cases by just trivializing the law, right? Nobody thinks that effectively what you end up with in a CP law is, you know, all F's are G's except when they're not, right? You end up with something that's still a substantive claim, it's just one that has exceptions. So this looks like a promising strategy for saving leeway incompatibilism, right? You sign up to CP PAP, and suddenly the Frankfurt case no longer looks like a refutation of our principle, right? It's just a deviant case. So here's an analogy that comes from Anne's paper, and this comes from a paper of Elliot Sober's, and Sober calls it Darwin's conditional. Here's the law. If organisms possessing a property P are better able to survive and reproduce than organisms possessing an alternative property P prime, and P and P prime are heritable, then the proportion of organisms in the population having P will increase. Now, Darwin's conditional as it stands as just false. So this is a quote from Anne. This, as Sober points out, is only true ceteris paribus. It might just so happen that many more organisms possessing property P are wiped out in freak disasters, or the effects of genetic drift might be particularly significant, and so on. But despite these exceptions, we think that this generalization is important in explanations of organisms' traits around us. We can appeal to this generalization to explain why such and such a species has this feature and make counterfactual assertions regarding how the species might have turned out differently in other environments. The generalization matters, she says. And so that's the important point I want to say. The generalization matters even though it has exceptions, right? It's just a ceteris paribus generalization. There are or could be deviant countercases. But such countercases don't show us that that generalization doesn't tell us anything important about how evolution works. On the contrary, it tells us something very important about how evolution works. So the source incompatibilist response to CP PAP, I take it, is to say, look, it might be true that ceteris paribus people are only more responsible if they have the ability to do otherwise. But just to deny that its truth, as it were, preserves the importance of alternative possibilities. And I want to say, you don't need to think that. You could think, no, its truth preserves the importance of possibilities in just the way that Darwin's conditional preserves the importance about some feature of heritability. So here's Linda Zagzebski on the irrelevance of alternative possibilities. She says, those who seek to find alternatives to PAP that deliver a revised AP requirement, which CP PAP is, might succeed, but even if they're right in thinking that the agent has APs in Frankfurt situations, the point of Frankfurt cases is that, quote, we just don't care what Black's mechanism is capable of doing because it doesn't actually do anything at all. And since the lack of alternative possibilities is tied to what the mechanism's capable of doing rather than to what it actually does, we see that we don't care whether or not the agent has alternative possibilities. Either way, she's responsible, right? So Zagzebski, being a source incompatibilist, wants to claim that we just don't care whether or not the agent has alternative possibilities. That's the message that we should take away from Frankfurt. So here's some more on Zagzebski. We libertarians think that Frankfurt was right in his point that the agent is responsible because what he does in a Frankfurt situation is relevantly similar to what he would have done if he'd been able to do otherwise. But it's also important that Black's meddling is a quirk that in the normal course of events would not have entered the picture at all. The point could be put as follows. It's only an accident that Black exists, and if he'd not existed, the agent would have had alternative possibilities. But, she says a little bit later, talk of counterfactual conditions, like it's, you know, if Black had not existed, the agent would have had alternative possibilities, for the attribution of responsibility is a digression, she says. And I want to claim, you know, it's not. There's no reason to think that it is indeed a digression, unless you've already, as it were, signed up to a source incompatibilist view. There's no motivation just from the Frankfurt case to think of that feature of the Frankfurt case as it were, a digression. So she's trying to argue that alternative possibilities are not in themselves important for moral responsibility, but note how similar what she says here is to Whittle's line about ceteris paribus laws. So it's just unclear why Zagzebski's line motivates not thinking of alternative possibilities as crucially relevant to moral responsibility rather than just a digression, right? Kind of looks like you could take everything she says apart from that last sentence as motivation for accepting the ceteris paribus version of PAP rather than, as it were, junking an alternative possibilities requirement altogether. So here's my, you know, proposal one for how the Leeway incompatibilist might respond to Frankfurt, just stop there, right? Just endorse the ceteris paribus version of PAP rather than PAP on the grounds that, as with CP laws more generally, Frankfurt cases are just deviant. Right, so that's the first proposal. Here's the second proposal, and it's going to take me a little while to get around to it. Here's another analogy. Think about David Lewis's counterfactual analysis of causation. Now, this is kind of this might be a bit confusing because this is just an analogy. It's a slightly misleading analogy because, as it were, the content of the analogy is a little bit too close to the content of what people are talking about with Frankfurt, but it is just supposed to be an analogy, right? So what I say about causation and counterfactuals is just going to be by way of an analogy for what one might say about the Frankfurt case. I'm not importing any facts about the relation between causation and counterfactuals into the case, if you see what I mean. So Lewis thinks of causation as fundamentally a matter of difference-making. His basic analysis, this is going back to, 1973, went like this. This is the kind of like the first pass. C caused E. If and only if had C not occurred, E would not have occurred, right? So C made a difference to E. E counterfactually depended on C. Now, and as Lewis knew back then, that really basic analysis just fails in certain kinds of cases, and in particular, fails in cases of preemption and overdetermination. So think about the classic firing squad case. It's not true of any of the shots individually that had that shot not occurred, the victim wouldn't have died, right? Because the death of the victim was overdetermined. And yet, clearly, fairly clearly, each of the individual shots was a cause of the victim's death. That's a problem for Lewis. The second kind of problem for Lewis is preemption. So here is a slightly hazy version of a case of trumping preemption of Jonathan Schaffer's, which was a big problem for Lewis. It goes like this. So we're in a magic world. Merlin and Morgana are wizards. They cast spells. Merlin casts a spell at midnight to turn the prince into a frog, 24 hours later, let's say. Morgana casts a spell to turn the prince into a frog a little bit later on in the day, a few hours later. Here's a law at Magic World. The law is, it's a causal law. It says, whenever you have two wizards casting the same spell to make something happen, it's the first spell that gets to cause it. The second spell is kind of rendered completely causally inefficacious, right? The work's done, there's nothing left to do. Morgana's waving her wand around. Actually, she's not doing anything at all, right? If Merlin hadn't cast his spell, then her spell would have caused the enchantment, but because Merlin's already cast his spell, she's not doing that. She's just waving a stick around. Nothing's happening. So that's a case of preemption. And we're supposed to suppose that this is what makes it a trumping case. There's no, as it were, sort of causal medium by which Merlin's spell gets to connect to the enchantment. It's the magic world, right? He casts a spell. The spell is cast. 24 hours later, prince turns into frog. There's no kind of intervening process. That's the way the case is set up. Now, this is a problem for Lewis's analysis because clearly it's not true that had Merlin not cast his spell, the prince wouldn't have been turned into a frog. If Merlin hadn't cast his spell, the prince would still have turned into a frog because then when Morgana waved her stick around, she would have been casting a spell and the prince would have ended up turning into a frog. Anyway, right, so it's clearly true that Merlin's casting the spell caused the enchantment. It's clearly false that had he not cast a spell, the enchantment wouldn't have happened. Now, those kinds of cases turned out to be a really tough nut to crack for the counterfactual analysis. Those of you who know anything about the history of the counterfactual analysis of causation will know that. But here's what happened in response to that kind of cases of preemption. People just didn't give up on the central idea that difference making is kind of crucial to understanding the nature of causation, right? They didn't go, oh, I see now that difference-making not doesn't really have anything to do with causation at all. There must be something else going on. That's not what they did. I mean, just as a matter of kind of historical record. That idea continued to be alive and well and still is alive and well in various different guises. So what people did was they kind of went, things must be much more complicated than we thought they were. We want to hang on to the idea that we can give a story about causation in terms of difference-making, but we're just not going to be able to do it in the simplistic way. We're going to have to do it in a much more complex way. And off they went with their, you know, incredibly complicated counterfactual analyses of causation. So the trick is to try and say, as it were, how we can get counterfactual dependence and causation to line up properly in the face of deviant cases such as the Merlin and Morgana case. So that way of going, that project of trying to get causation and counterfactual to line up in the face of deviant cases, that's not a kind of CP approach to the basic analysis, right? It's not saying, causation is normally a matter of counterfactual dependence except in deviant cases, right? It's not that kind of approach. Rather, what people did was try and replace that basic analysis with a more complicated one that covers the deviant cases as well, but which retains the core idea that we're to understand causation somehow or other in terms of counterfactual dependence. So let's go back to Zagzebski. This is Zagzebski on the irrelevance of alternative possibilities again. So compare... I want you to compare Zagzebski to what Lewis ends up saying about, oh, not what he ends up saying, what he said temporarily at one point in his career about late preemption, which is this. So he was worried about preemption cases, and he toyed with the idea that we can think of the enchantment not as counterfactually depending on Merlin's spell, but as quasi-depending on Merlin's spell. So, as I say, the enchantment fails to depend on Merlin's spell because Morgana's... Well, in fact, she's not just waiting in the wings. She does actually wave her wand. It's just it doesn't do anything. Here was Lewis's quasi-dependent solution. Look, Morgana's presence, in fact, as things actually are, has nothing to do with the enchantment, right? She's just waving a stick around. So here's what we can say. We can say that the enchantment quasi-depends on Merlin's spell. Had Morgana been out of the picture, the enchantment would have counterfactually depended on Morgan's spell, right? So as it were, we abstract away from the things that are stuffing up the counterfactual dependence, and once we abstract away from them, we get counterfactual dependence back, which is what we want causation to be. So although E doesn't counterfactually depend on M, it does quasi-depend on M. Now, Lewis abandoned that solution, I think, largely because he's a Humean and he's not really entitled to making claims about what is and isn't kind of intrinsic to the process that leads to the spell, right? Because Humeans think the causation's a massively extrinsic matter. So, in fact, he didn't think that solution was going to work, but, you know, that's kind of not really relevant to the current point. What I want you to just think about is that way of trying to deal with this kind of case, right? That thinking of the case as being one where, oh, look, we would have had counterfactual dependence if only Morgana hadn't been in the picture. So now, compare what Zagzebski says, right? She says, look, Jones would have had alternative possibilities if Black had been absent, right? And yet she doesn't want to say, so you could think of that as it were, a kind of quasi-alternative possibilities way of... a sort of a quasi way of thinking about the importance of alternative possibilities for moral responsibility. Zagzebski doesn't do that, right? So the difference between Lewis on causation when he's talking about quasi-dependence and Zagzebski on moral responsibility is that Lewis takes quasi-dependence to preserve the idea that counterfactual dependence still captures the core notion of causation, right? By contrast, Zagzebski concludes on the basis of a similar kind of weird, deviant, quirky case that alternative possibilities don't really have anything to do with moral responsibility. So I basically want to claim that you don't have to go the Zagzebski line. You could go the kind of Lewis line and think of this as the moral that we should take away from the Frankfurt cases as being that we should endorse an alternative principle, a possibilities principle that's kind of analogous to Lewis's quasi-dependence solution in the case of causation. So, more Zagzebski. Here's what she says, and this is her positive source incompatibilist view, the reason why the agent is responsible in Frankfurt cases is that she agent causes the act, and agent causation requires that the act be causally contingent, right? So she holds the line that in order to be morally responsible, determinism needs to be false. Why does it need to be false? Not because it gives us alternative possibilities, but because it gives us the causal contingency of the act, and you need causal contingency in order for you to be able to be an agent cause of the act. What's causal contingency? Here's the principle. An act A is non-determined, causally contingent, if and only if there's a possible world W in which all the events in the causal history of A in the actual world occur, and in which A does not occur. I think she needs to add the laws in too. I suspect she might be working with a sort of dispositionalist view about causation. I'm not quite sure, but that doesn't really matter. So she's jettisoning alternative possibilities as having anything interesting to do with moral responsibility, and takes the key to incompatibilism to be agent causation, which requires causal contingency and hence indeterminism. But as it were, what's important about causal contingency, she claims, is not alternative possibilities, but, you know, just contingency. A principle of causal contingency clearly incompatible with determinism. So this is a proper incompatibilist principle. But notice the kind of slightly obvious fact that the principle of causal contingency is an alternative possibilities principle. It's just a slightly different alternative possibilities principle. The principle of causal contingency is defined in terms of alternative possibilities. Causal contingency is defined in terms of alternative possibilities. So admittedly, they're not the standard sort of alternative possibilities where we hold fixed the actual past and the laws, right? You don't get alternative possibilities of that kind in Frankfurt cases. Instead, what we do is we just hold fixed the actual causal history of the act, presumably the laws as well. So in particular, for example, we don't hold fixed the presence of black, and once you as it were, extract black from the system, you get a situation where there's a possible world with the same causal history, but where the act in question doesn't happen, right? So you get alternative possibilities. So Jones's decision to A is causally contingent because there's a possible world, viz. A world where black's absent, where the causal history of A and the laws are the same, but Jones does otherwise, right? That's the view. So part of Zagzebski's view is that free will and moral responsibility require causal contingency, that is, the agent must have what I'm now going to call inherent regulative control over what they do. So having inherent regulative control is just a matter of satisfying that causal contingency requirement. Inherent here signifies that we're supposed to abstract away from accidental features that play no actual causal role in the agent's behavior, just as in the case of preemption, we might say that the preempting cause, Merlin's spell, is kind of inherently a difference maker for the effect, the enchantment, even though the presence of Morgana masks that feature of the spell. So again, remember that this is all just an analogy. The counterfactual causation thing is just an analogy. So roughly, my thought is, look, you can think of inherent regulative control as standing to regulative control proper, as quasi-dependence stands to counterfactual dependence proper. And my suggestion is simply, this is my second suggestion, the libertarian could just stop there, right? We have a principle, viz., the principle of causal contingency, that is an alternative possibilities requirement on moral responsibility. If you're a libertarian, you could just say that that's enough, right? And now, why do we need causal contingency? Well, because it's a version of an alternative possibilities requirement, and alternative possibilities are really important for acting freely. That's what you could do, rather than doing what Zagzebski does and say, alternative possibilities aren't really important, that we need causal contingency because causal contingency is what allows the agent to be an agent cause of their act, right? None of that is motivated, as it were, by the Frankfurt cases. You could just stop with the principle of causal contingency and say, look, we still have an alternative possibilities requirement on the table. Okay, so let me say a little bit about inherent regulative control. So, as I say, we can just understand this as a modified alternative possibilities requirement on moral responsibility and free will, rather than as a necessary condition for agent causation. So, S has inherent regulative control over A, just if that causal contingency principle is satisfied. So in a Frankfurt case, Jones has to A in the circumstances. He can't, let's assume, do otherwise than A. Nonetheless, in A-ing, he manifests inherent regulative control over his A-ing. That's the idea. And the causal history of A could have been just as it was, and the laws just as they were, and yet Jones have refrained from A-ing, right? That's the idea. So there is an AP requirement still on moral responsibility, which we cash out by saying that Jones has inherent regulative control over his action, just as you might think that Merlin has, you know, is inherently a difference maker for the enchantment. Okay, so as I say, what makes Zagzebski a source incompatibilist is the additional claim that the reason why the agent is responsible in Frankfurt cases is that she agent causes the act, and agent causation requires that the act be causally contingent. So alternative possibilities are only important on Zagzebski's full view insofar as they're necessary for agent causation. Or rather, that's not really the right way to put it. They're not important at all. It's the falsity of determinism that's important for Zagzebski, because the falsity of determinism is necessary for agent causation. But as far as responding adequately to Frankfurt cases are concerned, we could just stop with inherent regulative control, right? That's the thought. Nothing so far as responding to Frankfurt's concern motivates that additional step from a kind of modified leeway incompatibilism to source incompatibilism, right? That's just a move that you just don't need to make. Okay, so, conclusion. Two leeway incompatibilist responses to Frankfurt that one could make. One is that you could think of the connection between the ability to do otherwise and moral responsibility as holding ceteris paribus. Remember, the central point here is that this doesn't make alternative possibilities unimportant or merely a manifestation of some deeper requirement, right? Remember the analogy with Darwin's conditional. The second response you might make is identify a deeper requirement and identify that deeper requirement as inherent regulative control, which is still essentially a leeway requirement on acting freely and not a source requirement on acting freely. So where does this leave us? I want to claim that leeway incompatibilism is not refuted by Frankfurt cases. So correspondingly, Frankfurt cases do nothing to justify source as opposed to leeway incompatibilism. Those two options that I just gave seem to me to capture the thought that indeterministic agents have a kind of leeway that deterministic agents lack. Obviously, as a compatibilist, I'm disinclined to think that deterministic agents need that kind of leeway. But nonetheless, it does seem to me that those principles capture the idea that indeterminisms do have a kind of leeway that deterministic agents don't have. So I myself think that that's a better way for the incompatibilist to go. When I'm lying in bed awake at night, you know, I find the idea that if determinism... here's one thing that doesn't keep me awake, right? I find the idea that if determinism's true, then the chain of causes of our actions flows right through us and back into the distant past, kind of completely uncompelling, or at least insofar as I do find that compelling, I find it just as compelling to think that if indeterminism is true, the causes of our action, the chain of causes kind of flows right through us as well, right? I just don't, yeah. That doesn't keep me awake. I kind of see the pull of the idea that acting freely requires the kinds of alternative possibilities that determinism deprives us of. Like, so the thing that bothers me is kind of the consequence. I still worry about the consequence argument. That could just be me. I don't know. But basically, speaking as a compatibilist, I think if I was, you know, wasn't now so kind of professionally committed to compatibilism that there's no chance of anyone persuading me out of it, got me sort of slightly earlier on, I might have thought of this kind of response to Frankfurt as something that might have kind of talked me out of compatibilism, maybe, in a way that the sourcehood arguments just kind of leave me cold. So as a matter of, you know, dialectical... two things. One, you know, if you want to be a leeway incompatibilist, go ahead, you can be, it's okay. Frankfurt doesn't actually cause you any problems. But second, kind of dialectically, that strikes me as a kind of incompatibilism that compatibilists generally feel the force of much more than they do source incompatibilism. Right, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, Yeah, let's start over there.
Yeah, thanks again for the paper. And like Dirk, I'd already heard it once. I'll change my question from the last time. I just want to suggest that of the two proposals that you're thinking of as the better way to support the incompatibilist project you have in mind, maybe the second one is the better of the two. And here's just why. I'm just wondering how the ceteris paribus is going to work if you change the example to now the kind that Al Mealy has introduced on occasion, where he's basically globalized one of these Frankfurt cases. So you can imagine an agent living out her entire life with the Frankfurt intervener nearby. And so then you might think that now it's a pervasive feature of this agent. And now, I mean, if it's metaphysically possible for one case, then you can replicate it for each action for a whole life. And if somebody says, well, look, it's still deviant with respect to all the other free agents, well, now do it for all the agents in a world, right? And you can make the intervener something like God, right? But of course, so what I was thinking was, your second alternative, where you identify this sort of deeper explanation of what accounts for the kind of freedom that you say is there, it could still be true that there are possible worlds in which, if the intervener weren't present, agents would be able to do otherwise. So the second proposal looks like it's better suited to help you with the globalized Mealy case that's spread across a population of free agents.
Right, yes, no, okay, good. I like that. Maybe that's right. So, yeah, I'd need to think about it. So it kind of, thinking about the analogy, what if we lived in a world where just everything had a backup cause, right? Absolutely everything. Then it would look like backup cause cases are not, right, they're not deviant cases, right? they're the norm, that's what happens all the time. And yet you might still think that, causes are kind of inherently difference makers, it's just the world is conspiring globally to make them never actually be difference makers. Okay, no, I like that. Good, I'm just gonna
arguing against my own view by proposing that for you, but what the hell? So.
Oh well, that doesn't seem good. I do find it. Yeah, I mean, I worry about thought experiments sometimes, and thought experiments that are that way out. A bit of me wants to sort of resist drawing any conclusions from them. Like, what should we say about a possible world where absolutely everything everybody does all the time has a backup cause waiting in the world.
That's called kindergarten.
I mean, you know, yeah, I'm not really sure what it would be to imagine that situation, so I'm slightly disinclined to draw any conclusions from, you know, what happens in, you know, the outermost reaches of modal space. But insofar as we do take that kind of case seriously, yeah, it looks right that the second one's going to work better than the first. Thank you.
Helen, this is partly just clarification, but it's sort of driving to a point. I'm thinking how someone who's a skeptic about the importance of PAP or leeway might respond to this. And it may be that actually I don't have the structure of the analogy that you're drawing between counterfactual analyses of causation and the Frankfurt style cases is right. So that's, you could help me with this. But I'm wondering in these cases, the wonder I've got is, the problem I've got is, could someone say, is there just a kind, when you say just stop with the, we bracket off black in the way that we bracket off Morgana. And when we bracket off Morgana, then we still are able to save the intuition that there's still difference making going on. And then by analogy, if we bracket off black, we can still save the intuition that PAP matters, that in this case, Jones really had the alternative possibilities. And then you can just stop and say, that's all we need. We're able to say that, and I take it that's sort of the structure. But now I wonder if I've got that right, if that's how it works, if the person who's a BAP skeptic about the importance of leeway could just say, well, the problem with that is it's okay if there's a kind of consensus about our intuitions that difference making still matters, and we can save that intuition. But all we've got now is the assertion that the intuition that PAP matters is there, but there's nothing to back it up. But I can still say, I don't see why it should matter. So yep. Is there something more? I'm just wondering if where the argument runs out here, where you just say, well, we can still say that PAP matters because we've got that. But if someone still says, well, I just don't get it, I don't see why PAP matters, you've bracketed it off, but I've still got, you see what I'm wondering? I'm wondering where the argument runs out.
Yeah, I don't think I'm assuming a certain mindset amongst some source incompatibilist, which kind of goes like this. Oh, we really, and maybe there are no incompatibilists of this kind, or maybe if there are, they don't want to admit to it. But it's kind of like, oh, you know, I really like the consequence argument. That was a great argument. And then Frankfurt comes along, and various people tried various ways of saving the principle of alternative possibilities. None of them really worked. Oh, damn it. I'm going to have to kind of retreat to... in some sense, a weaker position, right, which is that actually it wasn't alternative possibilities that I cared about at all, really. It was just the falsity of determinism. And now, of course, you can't just say, oh, it's just the falsity of determinism that matters because it's unclear why that should matter. And so now you have to reach for some further condition like agent causation or whatever. Now, not all source incompatibilists are in that position, right? Plenty of source incompatibilists were always source incompatibilists. They always thought that agent causation was what was needed. They always thought that that required indeterminism. I don't think I have anything to say to those people. I think if that was your view to start with, I haven't said anything that's going to talk you out of it, right? So it's more a... if, as it were, you started out as the kind of incompatibilist that was moved by the consequence argument and worried by the threat that was posed by Frankfurt, but kind of found yourself not wanting to give up the incompatibilism, but reaching to the source incompatibilism as another way of doing it, you didn't have to make that move. That's the idea. Yeah, so I don't know if I'm describing any actual people, but it strikes me that, you know, if you kind of look at the way that the debate has moved in the last, I don't know, 20 years or so, you know, you did have all of those kind of moves that the incompatibilists were trying to make, which were leeway moves, right? Flicker defense, the W defense, all of those sorts of things. And they sort of, and then, you know, Fisher came along and Dirk and said, oh, robustness, and everyone kind of went, oh, yeah, oops. And as it were, that created a space for kind of source libertarianism in particular to kind of have a sort of resurgence, and it was kind of as though, yeah, we're all incompatibilists, but it turns out that that leeway incompatibilism is not going to work, so now here's the view that we need to, yeah, so did that make sense? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, so I think I wanted to echo what Michael just said about the second response maybe being better. But I think my reasons are a bit different. So I'm really puzzled by the ceteris paribus response. I don't think I really understand it. And I think the reason I don't understand it is because I take it that Frankfurt's original claim, I mean, it's a claim about a necessary condition. And I think we're supposed to understand it as something that's kind of a priori. So an agent's morally responsible only if they could have done otherwise. We're supposed to kind of have a priori philosophical grip, compatibilists and incompatibilists alike, somehow on that. Whereas, you know, the examples that Whittle gives to give us a grip on the ceteris paribus case is that, you know, they're empirical laws. And I don't know, maybe I'm stuck in the 50s or something, but those two things seem really different to me. And so... I guess I just don't see how you apply the ceteris paribus kind of thought to something that was meant to be an a priori claim made for philosophical reasons and still have something that's at all satisfying. So I don't know. I wondered if you could maybe say something about that.
Yeah, no, thanks. So actually the title of Anne's paper is Ceteris Paribus, I Could Have Done Otherwise. I think that's the title, and I think that's kind of an unfortunate title because, as it were, it focuses on the individual case, which is precisely where you don't want it, right? You want to focus, if you want to do the Ceteris Paribus thing, you want to focus on the idea that we have a general law here to which there are exceptions and not on the particular case, which is a case of an exception. So if you think about the Lewis analogy again, right, think about the claim that causation is a matter of difference making. That's not an empirical claim, right? You might think of that as a similarly an a priori philosophical claim about the nature of causation. And you might, although, you know, obviously Lewis doesn't do this because he wants to give a reductive story about causation, but you might take the view, and I think you find this in the causation literature quite a lot. People who aren't reductionists about causation will say, yeah, we can't analyze causation in terms of difference making, but clearly difference making is kind of like right at the heart of the notion of causation. That's the kind of thing people say, even though everybody knows there are lots of exceptions to the claim that causes are difference makers. So it seems to me that what I should maybe do is stick that in the paper, because I think that might be helpful. Because you're right, the example she does give are empirical examples. So I take it that in the causation case, it doesn't seem obviously wrong to think, no, this is supposed to be an a priori claim, and hence it will not tolerate an a priori claim about, as it were, each particular case, and hence will not tolerate exceptions. It does seem like at least a prima facie viable move to say, no, the a priori claim is a generalization, and it's a generalization that tolerates exceptions, right? So if you think about the Merlin-Morgana case, right, we're under no doubt at all, the way the case is set up, that Merlin is a cause of the enchantment and Morgana isn't, right? Even though there's no counterfactual dependence there. Of course, if you don't like the counterfactual analysis of causation, you'll say, well, that's because causation doesn't have anything to do with counterfactual dependence. Clearly, there's something else going on here. But plenty of people who do like the idea that there's a connection between causation and difference-making but don't want to think of it as a reductive analysis have just gone, yeah, there's a connection between causation and difference-making. It's a really important kind of conceptual connection. Just doesn't come out in this kind of case because they're kind of wacky cases. Yeah, that doesn't strike me as an... Yeah. Just because it's supposed to be an a priori claim, it doesn't strike me that we need to think of it as a claim that holds in every particular case. We can still think of it as a kind of Ceteris Paribus generalization rather than a...
Yeah. No, so that's really helpful. I see more clearly now what this kind of strategy might be. Okay. Thank you.
Thanks. So I think, unlike some of the people, Helen and Michael, I love this Ceteris Paribus strategy, and I actually think it could be generalized to most principles in the debate, compatibilist, incompatibilist. But I'm wondering how you could give some content to the Ceteris Paribus, and since I share your distrust of thought experiments, one idea could be this has to be a real life situation, you know, something that could happen in real life. You might even restrict it to normal agency, you know, ordinary conditions of agency. And, you know, it doesn't seem to me to be an a priori claim. It seems to be more of a moral claim. You're talking about when it's fair to blame and praise or hold somebody morally responsible, or at least that's one way of thinking about moral responsibility. So I think that if you think of it that way, then it's easier to think of it as a Ceteris Paribus claim, because most moral claims are that, moral principles. And I just think that's a really promising strategy for responding to a lot of arguments in this debate that get bogged down in this kind of fanciful thought experiment, counterexample, refinement kind of issue. So mostly I'm just so supportive and suggestions of how to fill it out.
Okay, great, thank you. So All right, so part of the idea, and I kind of like this idea, you're right, and this is kind of in a way also a response to Helen, right? If you think of most moral principles have exceptions, and we all know that, right? Think of it as a moral principle. Okay, no, I like that thought. So the other thought was, I wasn't quite sure what you were getting at with the real life cases.
So you want to fill out the ceteris paribus, right? You can't, otherwise it's ad hoc. Well, except for Frankfurt cases, or except for whatever somebody comes up with. So you want to generalize a little bit what the ceteris paribus clause, what the content of that is. And one way of doing it is to say, look, PAP works if it's a real life case, something that could happen under ordinary conditions of agency, maybe. Or maybe all you need to do is restrict it to real life. And no neuroscientists, no evil gods, no demons, no, you know, this is real natural life. And then it might work better.
I like that. Yeah, okay. Except, yeah, I mean, there are worries about. I don't want to build it in to the principle that, as it were, thought experiments are not on the table anymore. Like, come up with any thought experiment that's automatically excluded from, you know, falling within the remit of the principle. That kind of seems a little bit too extreme.
But also appealing.
To some of us, yes, not to others. But yes, thank you. Good, I think about that.
So I'm going to chime in with Michael and Helen and against Hamler on this. I don't understand exactly how the ceteris paribus move is supposed to work, because in a normal case where you have an exception, take something like the law, consuming arsenic causes death. Say, okay, now there's an exception. This guy consumes arsenic and he doesn't die. You think, well, there has to be some explanation where you describe the events of consuming arsenic. And then you also need some explanation for why it is in this case it doesn't actually cause death. And you can do that, and you say it's still a law that arsenic causes death. Well, in the case of moral responsibility, you say, okay, this guy's morally responsible even though he didn't have the ability to do otherwise. Well, what is it about him that makes him morally responsible? And then it seems to me like, and this goes back maybe to Michael's point, you could tell your story about inherent regulative control. That's why he's morally responsible. But then that does seem like a deeper reason. That seems exactly like a deeper reason that will then generalize to other cases.
Yeah, okay, good. Yeah, I think I just need to think about that. So I'm trying to think what Anne said. So Anne has stuff to say about this, and I just can't remember what it is. So if you take the Darwin conditional, right, whatever it was, the proportions will increase in these kinds of circumstances. There are exceptions to that, right, because there are circumstances where the circumstances obtain and yet the proportion doesn't increase. We can explain why in any given case that happened. Okay, so now we, in the Frankfurt case, so here we have a principle. You're only morally responsible if you could have done otherwise, whatever it is, or alternative possibilities. We have an exception. All right, if there are no alternative possibilities, then you're not morally responsible. Maybe that's another way of putting the principle, right? And here we have an exception because there are no alternative possibilities, and yet you are morally responsible. So now what's the explanation for your being morally responsible? Okay, if I put it that way around, it seems kind of worse. I feel like there's been an obvious answer to that, and I just can't pull it out of my head, but I need to think about it. So yeah, that was a really lame reply. I'm going to think about that. Thank you.
I think your inherent regulative control is one way to go, but it does change the law.
Right. Yes. No. I agree. Yeah. I mean, I kind of like to keep if I had to, I'd just give up the ceteris paribus thing and think of it as a as it were, a route into the inherent regulative trial. But I'd sort of like to keep it, but maybe I just need to not do that. But I think I need to go back and think a bit more about what Anne says about it.
Helen, the framing of your discussion, I thought was in terms of an idea like this, that we can reestablish the importance of the ability to do otherwise, to discussion about free will, by way of examining the Frankfurt cases and reestablishing the importance of ability to do otherwise for more responsibility. I thought that's what you were suggesting, and I wanted to raise an objection to that thought and see what you think. So it seems to me that it's sort of a part of our ordinary conception of our agency that often, say, particularly when one's deliberating about whether to do this or to do that, that it's up to me whether I choose to do this or choose to do that. And that if it turns out that that's wrong, then our conception of our agency is, in an important and interesting way, just illusory. It's mistaken. And that in itself is an interesting problem. And it's one that has nothing to do with moral responsibility. And is that part of the problem of free will? Well, it does seem that interest in free will throughout history has been in part interest in that. Of course, it's been in part interest in whether we're morally responsible for what we do. I would think that, however we come down on the Frankfurt cases, if free will just came to mean, well, whatever you need, whatever kind of control you need for moral responsibility, that would be an unfortunate instance of semantic drift. The term is a useful way of talking about the other kind of problem that I mentioned. So that would be a respect in which, as I said, I put it in terms of whether it's up to me whether I do this or that, which I think is perhaps even stronger than the thought, or that requirement is perhaps even stronger than the requirement that I'm able to do this or that, since after all, sometimes I can have abilities and it's not up to me whether I exercise them. But at least having the ability would be necessary for it. So anyway.
Good. I feel ambivalent about how much I want to focus on free will and how much I want to focus on moral responsibility. So like Tamla's suggestion was, you know, like if you focus on moral responsibility, the CP thing looks much more of a goer. And I mentioned, you know, the deliberation and, you know, it seeming like there are alternative possibilities, and that seems like maybe that's a necessary part of your self-conception if you're going to deliberate. So I kind of want to, hang on to that idea that this kind of line can speak to that sort of central case of deliberation. And I guess, all right, it's not obvious to me that, this is a very hedge way of saying, it's not obvious to me that I can't make the following response. Why don't I just make the response? Here's the response. So there's Jones, he's deliberating, right? He's in a situation where he thinks he's got, you know, he thinks he can decide to A or decide not to A, right? In normal circumstances, he'd be entirely right. As it turns out, you know, the world has conspired to make him wrong about that, but he's right about something, right? He's in a situation which, in normal circumstances, if you're a Leeway incompatibilist, would meet the requirements for acting freely, right? It just so happens that, you know, there's Black with his little button. And the claim kind of is, well, that's enough, right? So we don't need to think that in this particular case, he has alternative possibility. He genuinely has an alternative possibility, right? He's right when he thinks that he can decide to A or decide not to A. He just has to be in the kind of situation which, normally speaking, he would have those two options, right? So it's kind of like the, if you think about the Merlin Morgana case, right? Merlin's not wrong to think that he's right to think that casting the spell is going to cause the enchantment. He might think that he makes a difference to whether the enchantment happens. He's wrong about that, right? But he's totally in the sort of situation where if only Morgana hadn't been waiting in the wings, he really would be making a difference. So as it were, from his point of view, everything's as it should be. It's just that there's something out there that he doesn't know about that's messing it up. I think I kind of... This isn't going to satisfy all Leeway and incompatibilists, obviously, but that thought that I'm, as it were, from my own point, I mean, just the right kind of situation, right, for the conditions for acting freely to be met, and they are met. It's just that I'm wrong about, because there's the CP law that applies to me, and I think I'm not in an exceptional case, and I am in fact in an exceptional case, but I'm not wrong about, you know, being in the right sort of situation. I'm in the right kind of situation. That's the idea. Does that seem like it's an answer?
Yeah, so this is just a follow-up to the point about, or the suggestion that you might say that alternative possibilities are required in real-life cases, but maybe not in far-out thought experiments. So... I remember in Frankfurt's original paper, he does have a real-life case where Jones decides to, I don't know if it's murder Smith or something else, but whatever, let's say he decides to murder Smith, and then Black comes along and issues an irresistible threat unless he murders Smith.
Yeah.
And now the idea is that he can't do otherwise, but he's still morally responsible. That is like a real-life case. It's not like a far-out thought experiment. But then I thought, again, I don't think it's a hard bullet to bite to say that he's not morally responsible for what he does in the irresistible threat case. I don't think there is a strong intuitive pull. I guess, Frankfurt obviously thought that he was morally responsible anyway, but I don't really see a strong intuitive pull here on my own part, the way I do if Black just puts something in his brain and Jones doesn't even know about it and Black is just monitoring him and so on.
Good, thanks. You're right, so in the irresistible threat case, in order for this to be a kind of real life version of the nefarious neuroscientist case, right? This has to be a case where, right, Jones is already kind of committed to doing A, right? And then the irresistible threat comes along, and it's like, yeah, but that's not really relevant because I was going to do this anyway. Like, you just threatened to murder my entire family unless I, you know, have a cup of tea. Well, look, I was going to have a cup of tea anyway. Makes no difference to me. I take it this is one of the reasons why Frankfurt shifted to the kind of more science fiction-y case is, so, right, one problem with that kind of case is that it's just sort of not very clear whether you should think of the irresistible threat as kind of part of the causal process that sort of led to the action. I mean, it's not, Jones hears the threat, right? It's like, oh, someone's just offered, you know, said they're gonna kill my entire family unless I have a cup of tea. It's a little bit, because I have kind of conflicting intuitions about causation sometimes, it's a little bit unclear whether we can really think of that as just not part of the causal process at all, because if we do, it's kind of like the causal process sort of has a bit of a gap in it where the threat is being issued and you're like, la, 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 la. Right, could there be real-life Frankfurt cases? That's the question, right? And maybe that's... Okay, so your thought was, yeah, there could be here's sort of a real-life case, but maybe in that kind of case we can still follow Tamla's suggestion because actually this isn't a case of moral responsibility, so...
Hi. I liked the paper a lot. I thought it was great. This is not a criticism by any way, but I wonder if you could expand the conclusion, like why can't a compatibilist give... a similar argument. You know, source compatibilists talk about the actual causal sequence and the relevance of the fact that Black doesn't play a role in the actual causal sequence, but there's no presupposition of indeterminism in that story, right? And so And there's nothing about the Lewis account of causation, at least as far as I know, that entails indeterminism, right? So could you give a similar compatibilist response?
Oh, yeah. So the previous version of this talk had this in, and I just left it out of this one. So so how would this look if you were a Leeway compatibilist, right? You can do the CP law stuff. That all goes through, and Anne's very explicit about that in her papers. Like, she doesn't care whether we're talking about Leeway and compatibilists or compatibilists. The thing that you can't do is the inherent regulative control thing, because it's just not going to turn out that the actual causal... If determinism's true... Oh, God, is this right? I hope this is right. The actual causal process is not going to be... I mean, okay. Inherent regulative control, as Zagzebski defines it, is an incompatibilist, is something that you can only have if incompatibilism's true, right? Because the actual, there is not going to be a possible world with the same past and the same laws where, you know, Jones doesn't A, right? What I haven't thought about is whether you could give a compatibilist version of that principle. Okay, good. And on the face of it, yeah, on the face of it, maybe you could do a sort of Lewisian local miracle compatibilism kind of version of that principle or something that would make it consistent with determinism.
Yeah, I mean, the intuition of the source incompatibilist just is that black isn't playing a causal role, but there's not an assumption there of the truth of indeterminism, otherwise it wouldn't support source compatibilism. So you could kind of tell a similar story, it wouldn't maybe be the same story. I can't tell from your account of inherent regulative control. It doesn't seem to me that it entails the truth of indeterminism, but maybe it does. There might be another analogous. I wrote a paper in 93 that Michael criticized, which tried to give a compatibilist account. It was very similar to this in certain respects.
So Zagzebski's principle, as she states it, requires incompatibilism, but if you think of inherent regulative control as it would something that you might fill in with some slightly different principle, I don't see why one couldn't fill it in with a compatibilist principle as well. Yeah, no, good. That's, yeah, thank you.
All I just wanted to say is I don't see why, if you, for compatibilists, you wouldn't just deploy the sort of machinery that Kadri Vivalan uses. It's a very similar picture.
But just do so, what, sorry?
But deploy Kadri's resources. So, you know, however you set it up, however it is you're going to filter out the intervener, what's inherent are features of the agent that are intrinsic to the agent, that are the grounds for the abilities that involve the abilities to do otherwise. I mean, one of the things when I said I saw your paper before, I pointed out that I thought what was cool about it is it looked like it was using roughly the structure of argument that Kadri Vivalan used.
Oh, okay.
But instead for incompatibilists rather than compatibilists. So I'm just helping you and Joe out. That's all.
Okay, good. So is Kadri here?
I mean, maybe I'm wrong about this. I mean, Kadri's here. I should speak for herself.
Are you here, Kadri?
I think she is. Oh.
She's not here. Yeah. So I can't ask her. Right, so now I can say something about her book. I need to go back and read her book. Because when I read it, my worry about the way that she deals with the Frankfurt cases is that she doesn't really deal with the robustness objection. She kind of goes, look, there are alternative possibilities. We're all done now. Everything's fine.
Yeah,
and I was to say, yeah, but
I should
worry.
Be more careful. I was just painting a broad brush stroke.
So
I just
I'm not
thought,
sure. Yeah. So I'm not sure, but it might be that the thought that she's getting at is precisely the same idea. No, that's a nice thought. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, great. We spent the time excellently. So thank you very much.
Thank you.